I'm sure many of you guys have noticed the online narrative that I used to be an avowed communist and I have betrayed the comrades, as it were. And I wanted to kind of give some context on my sense of humor and my history with this stuff. AI could automate all the farming, weed out systematic corruption, thereby bringing us to as close as possible to genuine equality. So basically, everything that everybody loves about communism, but without the collective farm.
Elon Musk has so many simps, it has become completely unbearable. One of the richest men in the world, who has so many different grifts of these weird products, which just seem to be reinventing the wheel, like those ridiculous tunnels that go under California and everything like that. He's also a very exploitative businessman, just in his general practices. But he's also one of the richest men on the planet. You do not get there without crushing people, without exploiting so many people and extracting that wealth from your workers. Now, today's video isn't going to be about why Elon Musk is so bad. I've made multiple videos on that. So if you type in the Kavernacle, the cult of Elon Musk, I've done one about David Dobrik and influencers. I've just done one about him in general. But today I want to focus on the mother of his child, the artist known as Grimes. And we're going to talk about her weird politics and her weird transition from becoming like this real indie artist who seems to be pretty left-leaning and then having a child and being in a relationship with Elon Musk. Before we get any further, I'm going to plug my social medias and Patreon for about a minute. Before we get any further, a lot of my work on this channel is demonetized because when you're covering more serious, sometimes edgier topics, YouTube doesn't like this. So if you've ever enjoyed my work, please consider becoming a patron. And you don't have to pledge a crazy amount. I want to build up my Patreon based on as many people as possible pledging little amounts, like a dollar or two. So if, you know, you feel like I have ever brought anything that's worthwhile into your life and my content, please really consider becoming a patron to help me continue to do this, regardless of if YouTube monetize or not most of my videos in a given month. Also, if you want to join our communities, come check out our Discord and my subreddit. Those links in the description. And if you want to follow me personally, please check out the Kavernacle at Twitter, at Instagram, and also my personal Reddit, where you can keep up to date with all my content and what I'm doing. For every 5K, we get a new chocolate orange. Help me get the next one and get me to 40K. Also, I live stream on a Tuesday and Thursday, and those are always archived on the Kavernacle Extra, my second channel. So I'm gonna go through Grimes's like life and career and how she met Elon Musk and talk about her politics. But you guys might have seen her basically become Elon Musk's defense lawyer because lots of her fans hated Elon Musk when she got together with him and still really, really hate him because she's cultivated this sort of left-wing, anti-authoritarian, anti-capitalist fan base. So they always hated him. But then in her TikTok comments, someone saying, Grimes, how are you doing this? Actively sleeping with a man who is destroying the planet and humanity. And she says, how is he doing those things? His whole career is about making travel, house, power, etc., sustainable and green. It's worth a deep dive, love heart. Another TikTok user said if she could confirm that Musk is not a men's rights activist. Some people online have been saying that and I'm concerned. Grimes responded, he's not deaf. He's been very immature at points on Twitter. But for example, the president of SpaceX is a woman, as is his right-hand person at Neuralink. And this is, of course, a legendary exchange. So Elon Musk tweets, pronouns suck. And she tweets back, I love you, but please turn off your phone or give me a doll. I cannot support hate. Please stop this. I know this isn't your heart. And Elon Musk has also tweeted stuff like take the red pill. So that's why people think he's a men's rights activist. Now, apparently this is Grimes' mother who said, if your partner went through a challenging pregnancy and childbirth in the last 2 weeks and you were over 16 years old, would you be blaring men's rights activist bullshit Twitter right now? So I'm guessing Christmas around their family's house is a fun one when your mum really hates your partner. I'm going to talk about the Grimes communism stuff as well a bit later, but this was a funny tweet I also saw. Grimes quoted Stalin in her yearbook, "Gaiety is the most outstanding feature of the Soviet Union, Joseph Stalin." So how do you get from quoting Joseph Stalin to becoming the partner, having a child with literally one of the richest people on the planet? So just to go a little bit into her background. So when Grimes was a girl, she startled classmates at her Catholic school by telling them that she was the devil. To prove it, she spider-walked backwards down the stairs like Linda Blair in The Exorcist. She grew up in Vancouver, tormented at school by her peers who believed that she was some kind of odd and tussling at home with her four brothers. It was a strict household and an accomplished one. Her mother, Sandy Garasino, was a Crown prosecutor and is now the editor-in-chief of the Vancouver Observer, an online publication. Her father is an executive at a biotechnology company. Then, as now, she was rebellious. At 13, she shaved her head, after which she found herself spending her days with fellow outcasts, kids who were gay, kids who dressed strangely, kids who were obsessed with alternative music, like socially marginalized high schoolers everywhere. She developed a taste for Nine Inch Nails and the Smashing Pumpkins and Marilyn Manson. Now, the Rolling Stone did a really, really good long feature on her as well, just talking about what she's like in terms of what she's obsessed with. And they also tell the story about how she met Elon Musk. So it says, "She loves to ponder the possibilities of artificial intelligence taking over the creation of art, not to mention the rest of human society," and we're going to get back to this later with the communism stuff, "and is drawn not only to the synthesizers but to the synthetic, from virtual reality to hair dye. Her hair is currently black at the roots, transitioning into a bit of blonde and pink on top with an orange ponytail. She even somehow loves the artificially of the chemical oozing air fresheners favored by Uber drivers." Now, what's funny about this is that Grimes actually plays a character called Lizzie Wizzy in Cyberpunk 2077, and you do a quest for her where she slowly becomes like more evil because she's chrome. Basically, most of her body has been replaced by metal. I think I actually have a poster of it there. She's there. And she has like one song in it as well, which is actually quite a good song.
"The world would eat it up. A tale of the temptation to control another's memory. A grim reminder that a person is merely a collection of bytes that can be copied, reproduced."
You kind of get the impression, if this is a possibility, she might actually become Lizzie Wizzy in real life. Now, she also talks about how she met Elon Musk. So she says, "She confirms a story that Elon Musk first messaged her after seeing she had been the only person alive to tweet a hyper-specific, hyper-brainy pun involving Rocco's basilisk, a thought experiment about a murderous AI. She simply did not grasp the extent to which a relationship would come to define her image, especially with a broader public that didn't know her music, which for all of its brilliance and subcultural popularity has never been on the commercial radio." So her obsession with AI seems to be a key draw to Elon Musk, who is also quite obsessed with AI and, you know, the Neuralink thing. How much that has moved out of the conceptual phase and, you know, the prototype phase, pretty debatable. But here is something he's developing which is meant to fit in your brain and is an AI that's meant to help you and stuff. But I'm going to talk about Elon Musk's appeal to this sort of demographic a bit later. But then it also talks about how her fans reacted. So it says, "If you stare long enough at the digital abyss, it will stare back at you, and eventually it might not like what it sees. At least the vocal minority of the online world turned against her hard and fast. As the relationship with Musk became public, 'Break up with Elon now,' was one emblematic tweet from a fan. 'I was hard left before,' Grimes says. 'I still actually sort of am, but there's the obvious dissonance of my boyfriend, and I think this is the crux of most of the rage. Inevitably, her relationship with a tech billionaire who has made political donations to Republicans was painted as hypocrisy." Now, when one of her fans pointed this out, that it was like hypocritical and like sort of went against a lot of her beliefs and upbringing, she said, "Every aerospace company has to donate to Republicans in order to function. In fact, most major companies across the board do in some capacity. It's the price of doing business in America. Elon donates way more money, like absurdly more, to environmental causes." So through some of the replies I've shown you, you're probably getting the gist now that she seems to convince herself a lot of what Elon Musk does is actually very justifiable in the broader context of him supposedly doing good. Now, in this Rolling Stone interview, she also spoke about what she saw in Musk and how she can, like, support someone like Bernie Sanders and obviously love Elon Musk's agenda at the same time. So she says she sincerely believes, as she'll explain, that Musk is a force for good, and she also supports Bernie Sanders for president. The times are very unstable, she says, and people are comforted by black and white and easy to understand. Society is in this big fight to change, and when you're in a war, you have to be good side, bad side. It's not like a welcome time for nuance, understandably so. She's convinced Musk is not just changing the world, but potentially saving it, pushing away from fossil fuels with Tesla, nudging humanity to space with SpaceX, potentially repairing brains of Neuralink. In particular, she believes he is in a position to help stop climate change, the dangers of which loom over her new album. I just really, truly, utterly believe in sustainable energy and the electric future and making humanity a multi-planetary species, she says. There are a lot of problems in the world that we need to solve. The government does not truly have the capacity to solve them. My boyfriend is actually doing it, tangibly, visibly, like you just can't deny it. She still remains concerned about income inequality and says, it was something I spoke about a lot before dating my boyfriend, which is one of the reasons people were upset about our relationship, she says. But in her mind, Musk isn't buying yachts. If someone's just going to take everything and just put it into R&D to make the world better and just get up at the crack of dawn every day and go to bed really late every night, doesn't take vacations and actually just puts every single ounce of his energy in everything he cares about and all his money into making the world better, like, I can make an exception. I admire it a lot and I think it's great to me. It does not contradict my beliefs. When I look at the aims of my boyfriend and the aims of Bernie, like, their end goals are very similar. Fix environmental problems, reduce suffering. It's worth dissecting the wealth gap. It's worth dissecting the existence of billionaires, but situations have nuance. Now, she obviously loves Elon Musk and thinks very highly of him, but it's not really hard to, you know, see through her arguments quite quickly, mainly because he hasn't shown great temperament in being this leader. Like, would anyone seriously trust him just based on his Twitter profile with leading a colony on Mars? Would anyone trust him to treat these people fairly? Now, Elon Musk, like I said, I'm not really getting into everything bad about him. He also personally union busted in his own factory, right? Just people who wanted the right to organize, to make their conditions better, and to have a bigger voice. He personally met the guy leading this effort and basically threatened his job, right? This is the sort of guy I'm meant to trust with saving the whole planet. But it seems like with many people that Grimes has been seduced by the persona of Elon Musk, by the image of Elon Musk. And of course she knows him personally. But if you take him seriously, you can't say that Tesla cars are changing the world. They're completely unaffordable. Why would anyone buy a Tesla car over a petrol car or over another, you know, electric car or hybrid, which is cheaper? Why is anyone going to buy this? And if you pre-order one of their newer models, they don't even know when it's coming out. So only these weird Bitcoin simps seem to be the only people who care about Tesla. Because surely, if you're talking about cutting down CO2 emissions, then why aren't you making a Tesla that everybody, you know, who needs a car can afford, instead of making them, you know, pretty expensive for your average person? But, you know, she cares so much about income inequality, she also plays defense lawyer for Elon Musk union busting, and she tweeted, "He has never prevented them from unionizing. It's quite literally fake news. Trust me, I've investigated this heavily and even visited the factories. I have the receipts, but since it affects others, I'll wait till I AMA with imminent new music before I answer more queries." So it seems like she really just loves the idea of Elon Musk being like this Tony Stark billionaire. All he does with his money since he's been reformed is put it to good use, and all he wants to do is help humanity. And also, she doesn't seem to realize the problem with Elon Musk being this wealthy is he's just pretty untouchable. The same with most billionaires, is that this money translates to political power. It makes you untouchable. It makes you influential. It allows you to influence policy in the most powerful nation of all. This is also the guy who was celebrating the Bolivian coup, so Tesla could get easier access to lithium. Again, am I supposed to believe this guy really has the best interests of the whole world at heart when he's supporting far-right coups in other poor countries. Now, before we move on to the Grimes communism stuff, I just thought it'd be funny to see the letter that Elon Musk sent to Tesla staff during their move to form a union. So many of them wanted to join the United Auto Workers Union, so he writes them all a letter. And imagine if you're working in a Tesla factory and you're one of the leaders of this, you know, movement to form a union. So he says, "For Tesla to become and remain one of the great companies of the 21st century, we must have an environment that is safe, fair, and fun as possible. It's incredibly important to me that you look forward to coming to work every day. For that, we must be a fair and just company, the only kind worth creating. That's why I was so distraught when I read the recent blog post promoting the UAW, which does not share our mission and whose true allegiance is to the giant car companies, where the money they take from employees in dues is vastly more than they could ever make from Tesla. The tactics they have resorted to are disingenuous or false. I will address their underhanded attacks below. While this discussion focuses on Fremont, the same principles apply to every Tesla facility worldwide." Now, he basically just goes to talk about like how Tesla is a great place to work. I thought you'd guys be interested in the closing paragraph titled Fun. So listen to this. "As we get closer to being a profitable company, we will be able to afford more and more fun things. For example, as I mentioned at the company talk, we are going to hold a really amazing party once Model 3 reaches volume production later this year. There will also be little things that come along, like free frozen yogurt stands scattered around the factory, and my personal favourite, a Tesla electric pod car roller coaster with an optional loop-the-loop route, of course, that will allow fast and fun travel throughout our campus, dipping in and out of factory and connecting all the parking lots. It's going to get crazy good. Thanks again for all your effort, and I look forward to working alongside you to create an amazing future, Elon." So this great visionary of the future thinks that his workers that aren't paid enough, overworked in one of the most expensive places to live in America, can be bribed with promises of frozen yogurt and parties and a roller coaster. Does he think all his workers are as childish as him? Again, am I meant to trust this guy as his, like, Tony Stark visionary? And that's what it feels like, is that Grimes, if she is holding on to these politics, is buying into the image of Elon Musk and is naive to the reality of him. And that sounds weird, as close as they are, they have a child together. But it seems like she is also bought into the cult of Musk. Now, I also want to talk about, obviously, like, her weird views on AI and communism. Now, part of the attraction to Elon Musk, of course, was the AI side. But now let's, you know, talk about these weird TikTok she was putting out. So you guys would have seen this one. I'm going to go through it. Basically talking about how AI is compatible with communism.
"I have a proposition for the communists. So typically, most of the communists I know are not big fans of AI. But if you think about it, AI is actually the fastest path to communism. So if implemented correctly, AI could actually theoretically solve for abundance. Like, we could totally get to a situation where nobody has to work, everybody is provided for with a comfortable state of being, comfortable living. AI could automate all the farming, weed out systematic corruption, thereby bringing us to as close as possible to genuine equality. So basically, everything that everybody loves about communism, but without the collective farm. Because let's be real, enforced farming is really not a vibe."
So that's obviously an interesting one. It also ignores a lot of the flaws in AI. And I don't know many communists who would be opposed necessarily to like more robotics and some forms of AI. But I feel like with AI simps like Elon Musk and Grimes, they're thinking about like these AI systems like Jarvis from Avengers or something that would like help us get to communism, rather than just being things that would operate machinery. And obviously there's a massive problem with AI, is that AI often reflects the inherent biases of the people who create them. So if Elon Musk and his team at Tesla, for example, create an AI like Jarvis who can maybe run a farm on its own. Autonomous farming, wouldn't that be great for the human race? Or it could manage some sort of system or society. Maybe it could manage law enforcement. Whoever programmed it is going to leave their inherent blind spots, biases, prejudices in it. So the AI, instead of being like this being that is not biased at all, will have the biases of the people who create it. This is actually a problem ongoing right now. It's not something just reserved for the future. But like I said, maybe there's a role for like basic forms of AI in like a communist society if we ever got there. But to say that like AI is like this great solution to get inequality, I think is quite a false one. Now, people were clowning her, saying she doesn't know like anything about communism and it's ridiculous. And what she was saying at least shows that she doesn't have a negative opinion of communism. But also she wanted to address if she was a communist or not, because obviously that quote I showed you at the start had Joseph Stalin being quoted. Now, here's what she had to say about like her obsession with like the USSR and everything like that.
I'm sure many of you guys have noticed the online narrative that I used to be an avowed communist and I have betrayed the comrades, as it were. And I wanted to kind of give some context on my sense of humor and my history with this stuff. So I had kind of a crazy Yearbook quote, which is, gaiety is the most outstanding feature of the Soviet Union, which is, you know, by Joseph Stalin. So this is the backstory, basically. I'm kind of like an obsessive history fan, and I was really, really obsessed with the Soviet Union in high school. Still kind of now. So when I started at my high school, it was like covered in beautiful murals. But it was kind of a crazy high school, like lots of drug use and stuff. And admittedly, I got into a lot of trouble there. And when I was in grade 11 or something, we got this new principal who like painted all over all the murals gray. So this quote was not an endorsement of communism. It was actually a reference. I was sort of like making a dark joke comparing my school to the Soviet Union under Joseph Stalin. You know, that the freedom of creativity was being oppressed and people were being sent to the gulag for not conforming. Stalin, like, murdered millions of people in the gulags and in World War II, and, you know, I think there actually are redeeming qualities about communism, but Stalin is not one of them.
Also, did she say Joseph Stalin murdered millions of people in World War II? Like, probably, like, the only good thing he did was World War II. Anyway, she talks about how she was an obsessive with the Soviet Union. She kind of still is. It seems like, just in general, she's quite, like, all over the place with her politics and her obsessions, in that, like, if I was someone who thought communism was quite redeeming and everything, I really wouldn't keep, like, associating it with Stalinism and Stalin's Russia, because even in Russia itself, you had de-Stalinization. You had the Russian government getting rid of his cult of personality around Stalin and trying to distance themselves away from this guy. So it feels like she's kind of like using him as a shield to be like, you know, I don't really think communism is great. Look at this guy, Stalin. He was so bad. And he was a communist as well. But obviously I can buy that it's just something an edgy teenager would do. And maybe she liked him at the time and doesn't now. Not that you could probably come out and say that. But even just from talking about like her upbringing there and like everything that happened in school, she seems such a mismatch for Elon Musk. And to end this video, I just want to finalize, you know, Elon Musk's brand and how it really does influence people. So I think what Elon Musk has capitalized on is how slow governments have been to both tackle climate change and progress with the space race, because you have those great posters in the Soviet Union back in the day, and I think this might be part of her obsession with things like space and technology, during the space race, about the Soviet Union colonizing other planets and just this really great propaganda that they would put out everywhere. And there's a lot of romanticism to the Soviet exploration of space and stuff. But of course, after the Cold War, the space race really, really died down. And while many people would think probably in 1960s, 69 when we landed on the moon, we'd be on Mars by now, like having a colony there. That just hasn't happened. So I think Elon Musk has taken the desire for many people who love science, AI, space and all that stuff, people to see humans explore the galaxy, which is so popular in science fiction as well. And he's directed it to his company. And because he's the most prominent guy doing this, and because he has this like meme-y personality, people think he's just like your regular guy and he's someone to look up to and he'll lead humanity to the stars. And that's also something with climate change, because there's a lot of people who have like an interest in science. So they think the solution to our problems is some kind of bad electric car, which most people in the world won't be able to afford. It seems ridiculous, but because Elon Musk has taken the enthusiasm for this technology and put it into this product, people buy into it. He makes these people believe that this is a solution to a lot of their problems. So for someone like Grimes, who has like this kind of weird, unconventional upbringing, makes this music which really doesn't fit into a box, really loves, you know, science fiction. She spoke about being raised on like things like Dune, the book and the film, and she was really into AI before she met Elon Musk. And here comes a guy who also loves this stuff, but he doesn't also love this stuff. He has enough financial power to make this stuff a reality. And it seems like to a lot of people, that's what he's doing. So for all his flaws, his immaturity on Twitter, for the way he treats his employees in the Tesla factories, to donating to Republican politicians and stuff, that is all forgivable because Elon Musk is actually just playing the game on Earth so he can help humanity achieve its real potential, whether that is AI bringing us closer to some form of communism, as Grimes is, you know, pointing out, or whether that is Neuralink helping us solve a bunch of problems, or whether that is SpaceX taking us to Mars and finally seeing a human settlement on another planet. That is the enthusiasm that Elon Musk buys into. But for someone like me, who is very passionate, especially about space, Elon Musk is not someone to be trusted. Because let's say he even gets to Mars, for example. Do you trust this guy to be in control of, you know, a whole territory? We only need to look back at European colonialism, where these corporations, led by people like Elon Musk, would literally set up their own countries. East India Company is probably the best example, but you had this in Latin America as well, with the Spanish and Portuguese. It doesn't really end well, and especially when he's so petulant, petty, thinks his workers can be bought off with yogurt and roller coasters. Yeah, I don't trust this guy. I'm not going to give this guy like the benefit of the doubt. I wish something like the UN would put more money into like a space program, because I feel like space shouldn't be about politics. It shouldn't be about capitalism and corporations. It should be like a human pursuit that we all do together. I don't want space to become like Earth, where corporations will just, you know, take over territory and found their own countries. You know, Rhodesia is a great example of something like that as well. So that is the weird politics of Grimes and her weird old relationship with Elon Musk. Let me know what you guys think down in the comments. Follow me on social media at the Kavernacle on Twitter and Instagram. If you want to support my work, check out my Patreon. Also join our communities on Discord and my subreddit. And if you made it this far, thank you all for watching.